Good afternoon. We're glad to have everybody here. I'm Burl Saunders, Chair of the District Council. First of all, I just want to thank this group of people for dedicating 2 days of their life. I know they will sleep well tonight. I'm sure you've had a long and arduous day, but we really appreciate them coming down and taking the time to look at a really important place in our region. I think this is a real key piece of property, and we're excited to see what you have to say.
The panelists you see, half are from Southside and half are from the peninsula on up to Richmond. So we were very fortunate to get such a talented bunch. And I think starting yesterday at 4:30 with the tour, I think we've all had a lot of fun. It's been a little fast-paced. A few of them have accused me of being mean when I was trying to get them to stick to a schedule. But I think we have a great recommendation for the city of Norfolk. And we'd like to thank Norfolk, in particular, Councilman members Riddick and Williams, who spent some time with us this morning. And it was obvious to all of us that they are very, very dedicated to this area, and they do want to see some change, and they're really encouraging that. And in addition, I would really like to thank the City of Norfolk's Economic Development Department, led by Chuck Rigney, and his team members, Mike Cutter and Janice Hurley, as well as Frank Duke, the Director of the Planning Department, and his team members, Paula Shea and Jeremy Sharp. In addition, we spoke with the city's Transportation Department, Police Department, and I don't know if we're missing anybody else, but they provided us a wealth of background information, and that really helped start the process about a week and a half ago when everybody got the background information on the study area projects. And the way all of this started is the city of Norfolk approached ULI, and they have been concerned about the corridor and have actively been working on the corridor, but wanted some new ideas, maybe with some folks from outside the area that weren't familiar with the study area. So that's how we assembled this panel. One thing to remember as we go through this discussion is that all the sites located within the study area, and I don't know if you all can see this, but you're welcome to come up afterwards and look at it. But all of the sites are privately owned. So the city right now does not have a lot they can do to change what's out there, but we think we've come up with some recommendations that may help them. And we want to stress that the corridor is not unique. In fact, there are many cities struggling with areas like this now that have seen better times and trying to come up with ways to bring these areas back to what they were or even better. In fact, the first slide I'd like to show is really this life cycle of retail complexes. And you can see the malls, which generally this is where Military Circle falls into. These really came about late 1950s, early 1960s. And you can see this indoor mall concept really died in about 1996. And what has replaced it is power centers. And if you look at the Target right down the street at Military Circle, the Target and the locations beside them, that's considered a power center. But right now, lifestyle and mixed use products are what is hot when it comes to retail centers. So I think you're going to see some recommendations where we've included these mixed use ideas. And what a lot of people in the area think is that maybe Military Circle has been suffering, and this whole study area has been suffering due to the demographics that surround the area. And that actually is not true. And I'd like for Blunt Hunter to come up and just talk a little bit about the demographics for the study area.
Thank you, Tara. Next slide, please. I mentioned that what I do for a living is to make consumer markets visible. The challenges that are associated with this study area are clearly not really related to the demographics of the location of the study area. This came as a surprise to the panelists, and it was something that we actually played a game with and created some surprises. I took the 8 major retail mall nodes in Hampton Roads: Military Circle, Greenbrier, Chesapeake Square, Lynn Haven, Pembroke Mall Town Center, Peninsula Town Center, Patrick Henry, and MacArthur Center, and looked at the demographics within a 3-mile radius of each, a 5-mile radius of each, and a 7-mile radius of each, which are typical drawing areas for strong regional retail nodes. And I looked at population and household count. I looked at race. I looked at income. I looked at the number of households with household income of $100,000 or more. And we found some very surprising and positive numbers. First of all, the node at Military Circle had the highest population of all eight in the 5 and 7 mile radii. At the 7 mile radius, the differential was more than 100,000 people over the second ranking center, which was MacArthur Center. So 100,000 person premium, that starts to talk to retailers. This is a story that we don't think they're hearing. When we look at average household income in the 7 mile ring, the average around Military Circle was $60,593. The U.S. average this year is about $50,500. So we're well above the U.S. average. What takes on extra meaning there is that Military Circle area ranked in the middle of the pack of this group of eight, not at the bottom as some people guessed. It was actually within 5% of the total income or average income at Greenbrier and Chesapeake Square and Pembroke Mall and Town Center in Virginia Beach. So some of these areas that were perceived as much more affluent are really not. Military Circle can hold its own in these conversations. We heard some disparaging remarks today about Military Circle's demographics, and this is a story that has to get out. Because of that density of population around Military Circle, when you look at the number of households with incomes over $100,000, and this is certainly a key group for retailers, Military Circle ranked number 3 out of these 8 at both the 5-mile ring and the 7-mile ring. And the spread was so close, 30,700 for Military Circle, 31,100 for Pembroke Town Center, 32,500 for Lynn Haven Mall, that you might be inclined to say they were all really tied. They were neck and neck. So we believe that these are some surprising demographics. You might not see these folks shopping at the node today. And to the extent that you don't, is the extent that the node needs to reinvent itself. The base population that it has as its potential audience is quite strong.
Thanks, Blunt. Next slide. So this was our first task given to us by the city, and we're focusing here on transportation. And our recommendations, one thing I did want to point out, light rail. I don't know if everybody here knows that there's a light rail stop on the other side of the corridor, other side of the interstate. What a lot of the property owners within this area didn't recognize is that that exists. We think that definitely the city, as well as the property owners, should be making much better use of the light rail, and we're going to talk about that in depth a little bit later. Our first recommendation really was that we incorporate the light rail stop into the study area, and we think that the overpass that now runs over Interstate 264 can be improved. And we were fortunate yesterday Kara risked her life, went out on the street and took this picture of what exists today, and the light rail stop is actually right over the other side of that bridge. And this is what Bob Mills, our architect, was able to sketch up this morning as an improvement. And we thought this really, just some, and I want to say simple touches, but I know there's cost involved, but just making this much more friendlier for pedestrians. Right now it's a little scary if you look at this. I don't know that I'd want to cross that area at night. There's not a lot of lighting. We're proposing additional lighting. What we're also going to talk about later is maybe looking at closing this to car traffic and making this more of a bike path as well as a pedestrian crossway to the light rail. And this empties out right into the Best Square site. On accessibility, we really thought...
Can we get handouts?
This will be available later after we're done, and we're going to have questions and answers at the end of the presentation as well. For accessibility, right now we have a population in the Poplar Hall neighborhood, basically an elderly population, as well as the Glen Rock neighborhood. There's a nice mix, but we do have more elderly folks living there. It is not a pedestrian-friendly area. So that is one suggestion. I know planning is currently working on this, but we think it's important to link both sides of the highway. And this isn't something that's going to be done immediately, but we think as we're looking at road improvements down the next few years that we need to consider pedestrian walkways. And immediately, we think from the light rail, a trolley or shuttle service to the Military Circle and Janiff Shopping Center would provide a simple answer to get the light rail folks moving from that side of the interstate to these shopping centers. Because again, right now, Military Circle and Janiff, as well as Best Square, none of these folks are able to get across to that area safely. Bob, maybe you want to talk a little bit more about some of the traffic patterns you had talked about in order to enhance pedestrian traffic.
Well, we, being urban planners, architects, we were kind of dreaming in some ways in regards to trying to slow the traffic down. We spent some time meeting with the city engineer, and he led us to believe there wasn't a lot of opportunity in terms of slowing traffic down, but we were looking for ways that we could promote more pedestrian crossing across the street. We were looking at three different levels of possible crossings. Surface level, which seems probably impossible. Overhead bridges, which have not proven to be great solutions. And even the idea that as the street or as the road gets improved over time, that perhaps there's a way under a tunnel type of way of moving traffic across. They all seem to be rather difficult situations at this stage of the game. But we threw them all out there just with the idea that as the roadway gets improved over time, that these are things that that can be considered. The movement east-west across the property, across the test area, is critical, and it's really not easy going right now. We were also, in speaking with the city engineer, we did find out that there was continued expansion and growth of the military highway north of this site. So basically what we have in front of Military Circle Shopping Center is basically what the goal is. So the out-to-out, the curb-to-curb on that is fairly well fixed. There is an access road, though, that runs parallel to Military Highway on both sides of the street up to a certain point that we believe is just a little bit redundant and unnecessary. And we were hoping that we could actually, and we're recommending that we actually take this service road to the side and make it pedestrian, make it space that we can do more greening, we can do bike paths, we can do pedestrian movement. We are recommending that signalization be further examined. We are recommending improvements and access to the Best Square property and the idea of improving the bridge across. That was a quick, easy idea. Perhaps maybe there's even a better bridge. Maybe it's just a pedestrian bridge in the future. And all in all, from a transportation point of view, we wanted to reduce asphalt. I mean, your first impression when you go through this section of the city is failure first, because businesses are, people are not parking in the parking lots. Huge seas of asphalt and huge seas of asphalt in the roadway. And so generally our idea is to find ways to reduce the amount of asphalt.
Okay, task two. Again, I mentioned that ownership of all these parcels are private, so it's a challenge for the city to get involved in trying to determine what happens there in the future. So we came up with some recommendations on what areas the city could look at in doing so. And the first we talked about is establishing incentives. And we talked about maybe an enterprise zone, but enterprise zones typically go in areas where the demographics aren't very good. And as Blunt explained, the demographics here are very good and promising. We also thought the city should look at creating a zone for the study area that where the city could incorporate a reduction of fees for the developer, maybe look at some tax incentives for anyone that can develop in this area. And I know Chuck and Frank have been thinking this way as well, but we know that would be an obvious way to encourage development. We also talked about developing an RFP for streetscape and signage enhancements. And I think all of you all know, as you go down Military Highway, the signage is not coordinated. And I know Frank has plans to look at the signage on that particular corridor. But everybody felt that it was very cluttered. Every retailer seems they have their own sign out there. They're all different sizes. So one of the things we're definitely looking at is reducing the number of signs and making them more attractive. But we have some examples of areas where they have been able to come up with some successful streetscape plans. And one of them right across the water from us is Coliseum Mall. And hopefully you all have had the chance to go to Peninsula Town Center, but we think the similar sign package that they have, where you come up with a logo, you have consistent signs, use the same coloring, all of that would help enhance this area. In addition, the panel thought it was very important to develop architectural guidelines. It's, again, hard to do with multiple property owners, but we're hoping that the property owners can come together with the city and develop a similar architectural style. Right now, in addition to the asphalt, that's the first thing you notice when you drive through the corridor, you also notice a very different type of style among the buildings as well as colors. Again, nothing is consistent within the corridor. Next slide, please. The city, we're putting a lot on the city, but we're hoping that many people can help with this effort. But we thought it was important to evaluate increased zoning density and also look at shared parking. And we know your planning department is, again, planning to do this down the road, but we think the sooner the better. Again, the sea of asphalt, a lot of that is parking, which was required back at the time where most of these retail centers were developed, but it is not needed. I mean, if you think about, I don't know how many acres of asphalt are out there, but when you think about what could be developed, even if it's green space, be a huge improvement. We also talked about establishing monthly meetings between the city, and this may be a few folks from different departments, with the current landowners. And we did have great participation from our landowners for the different centers. And we thought maybe having these monthly meetings to at least start some synergy, getting everybody on the right page. Right now, everybody's sort of focused on their own property, which makes sense. But if you look at the area as being one, I think we certainly can create some great synergy there. In addition, we thought it was very important to look at rebranding the area. Right now, it's known as the Military Circle Mall area, when you think about this entire corridor. But what we were thinking is that maybe we need to move away from Military, for example. This is certainly up for, you know, discussion for the city to decide, but maybe you need to come up with a peninsula town center type overall identity for the area. Okay, moving on to task three. This deals with streetscapes. This is what Jeff helped us out with, and this is just a small example. But by taking the utilities underground and just adding a little bit of landscaping, you can see a drastic improvement. And this is, again, something that could be done with little effort, we feel. Moving on to task four. Right now, retail is the predominant type of use in the area. But we thought it was important to consider some other types of uses, and we came up with a number of uses. And when we were talking about the school, right now it's not very friendly to children, and there are a number of outbuildings on the property. We also felt that, again, we need to talk with planning more, but given that Glen Rock and Poplar Hall, their neighborhoods may be going through cycles where more young families are moving to the area, we really need to look at that school. And I know it's not on the school board's near-term plans for improvement, but we saw that as vital to this area. In terms of fiscal tools, again, we realize the city does not have a lot of funds to contribute to this area, as most cities are having problems these days. But I'd like to ask Elizabeth McCrory, who has overseen the bid development for the Peninsula Town Center, to talk a little bit about how that was established with the city of Hampton and what they've already seen in terms of benefits.
Yes. Well, Coliseum Central was a result of declining retail sales. The five top property owners got together and said, hey, we've got a problem. We need to work together. The city came on as a strong partner, and the bid was formed with an overwhelming support at that time from the property owners. We represent 650 business and property owners in a 1,900-acre area. So it's a pretty large area if you're looking at bids throughout the United States. We are contacted all the time by localities who are looking at forming bids, most notably King of Prussia and one of the Northern Virginia counties whose name escapes me at the moment. And we just renewed in November of 2010 for a 10-year term with absolutely no opposition. The tax is an additional 7 cents on their real estate property tax. And the city does also match what the businesses raise. So we have about a $1.3 million budget. And we're responsible for the higher level of landscaping that you see, the banners, the gateway entrance features. We market the entire area through radio, television, billboards. And we also have two signature events, Neighborhood Night Out and Health and Safety Fair, which we had last Saturday, and our annual holiday parade. So we stay busy.
Okay. And then I'd like for John to talk a little bit about TIFs. His company specializes in TIFs and has helped many communities throughout Virginia. In addition, he's well seasoned on CDAs and came up with some nice alternatives for the city to think about.
Yeah, so we look at these types of projects all over the country, and there are a lot of these, as Tara said, a lot of these declining corridors and malls and shopping centers. We worked on Peninsula Town Center. That was clearly a different economical time. So the panel started looking at, you know, what can be done in today's economy with this corridor, and we said, you know, it may take one catalytic project to start to generate private development, to start redeveloping the entire area. And so that's when we come up with the idea of a developer RFP and saying, rather than the city taking a lot of time studying and looking at what may work at a certain property like Best Square or the Dump, let's put out a developer RFP, say you, the private sector, y'all come to us. Come to us with a tenant in place, whether it's a Costco expansion, a Costco relocation, whether it's a grocery store, like Junie mentioned, like a Kroger that's doing well in this economy, or whether it's a transit-oriented development. Come to us with a plan, with a tenant, come to us with your financing in place. And the panel did talk about it. It's likely that in today's economy, the city would have to offer some type of a public investment to get that transformative private investment. So we talked about public-private partnerships, we talked about bids, we talked about tax increment financing and community development authorities. And so there is one way of saying, you know, if you, the private sector, come in with a couple of tenants, then we're sure they're going to be there. The city has the ability to offer some assistance for the redevelopment of Best Square, for other public infrastructure improvements. And that may be enough to bring in a quality developer in today's economy that could redevelop one of these areas, which would hopefully spread to the others. So, you know, with TIF, you'd be saying if a developer comes in with a Kroger project, a grocery store project, we look at their projected sales and they say, what can we borrow versus those sales? And then you can put those improvements in up front. And so that's used a lot in today's economy to bring in the private sector, because otherwise they need to see some public investment before they're going to put in their money. And so the CDA is another vehicle you can overlay that with a TIF like we do with Peninsula Town Center. That gives you the ability, if the tax increment's not there in a given year, you can assess the property owners with the CDA. So.
The last task we were given is to try and come up with a timetable for these recommendations. We looked at the immediate term, which is 0 to 2 years. Then we looked at a midterm period, which we, you know, think is 2 to 5 years. And finally, the long term, which is 5+ years. So I'm going to run down these tasks, and I'd like for you all, or these recommendations in the immediate term. And if anybody has anything to add from the panel, please do. The first thing we thought was important was really for the city to communicate with Thor Equities, and not only Thor Equities, but find out who owns the paper on Military Circle and engage them, because if Thor Equities is reluctant maybe to make some changes, maybe the note holder will be interested in attempting to do so. We also thought it was important to establish a business association, and whether this is just a get-together of businesses within the area, or maybe it's the city coming out and talking to these business owners, retailers, etc., talking about improvements that are coming down the road. We just thought it was important to start establishing communications with all the stakeholders. Third thing is, right now we know that economic development has been talking closely with Costco, and I think we've all read in the paper that they're looking for a bigger site, which Norfolk currently doesn't have. But we think there may be some ways to tackle that. But we'd like to encourage economic development to continue with these discussions, as well as conduct a market analysis for the area to determine what retailers may want to go here, but more importantly, what the mix of uses should be. Do we need office in this area? Is more residential housing needed? Just determine what the demand is for this area. We also recommended that the city develop an RFP for design construction and streetscape enhancements, as well as looking at signage package. And again, Mr. Duke also mentioned that they were looking at doing so. Work with the existing property owners on Best Square and the Dump, because we think that those two properties may be the ones that will benefit immediately from some of these improvements, particularly with the light rail access. We talked about expanding the light rail line. Now, this is down the road, but I think we're talking about just planning for it now in the immediate term. Just look at what may happen if you take light rail spurs all the way down to Virginia Beach. Of course, that's not going to happen anytime soon, but it's important to start thinking about it. And we really think in the immediate term that we could start that trolley system from the light rail location to these retail areas as well as businesses currently in the study area. Next, please. We talked about a big idea and a vision, and we're going to show you, I think, some suggestions that may be surprising. Some, you know, you may not like, but these are all up for discussion. Most importantly, we thought it was important to rebrand the area, and we've mentioned this a couple of times, but this really should be done by the city and some of the stakeholders. We, you know, think the city and not an outside agency should start thinking about this first. And definitely redevelopment of the best square and the dump area is very important. We thought that could be done immediately, and we have had discussions with one of the landowners, and they seemed very open to these discussions. I think Bob already talked about eliminating the feeder roads. That's something we felt that could be done within a 2 to 5 year period. And we also felt that it was important to keep trying to attract private investment to the Military Circle Mall area and work with those private investors and create access points to the developments. Right now, if you go to Janif or Military Circle, and I've been going there all my life, you're not really quite sure where to turn to access what retail or what office space. So, that is something we felt could be done in 2 to 5 years, which would be a great improvement. And light rail, again, we can't emphasize enough how important light rail is to this entire study. Guys, anything else on 2 to 5? Okay. Moving on to 5+. We looked at the gallery at Military Circle, hopefully operating under a new name. Becoming a major destination. And this probably involves redevelopment of the site. We thought that density increases due to multifamily housing really needed to be looked at, and we need to keep continuing to focus on increasing property values within the area. We talked about light rail already. And we hope within a 5-year period, the city sees some immediate results from an expanded tax base, see some revenue generation coming back within this time. We also recommended that the city consider taking the same rebranding effort, same signage, architectural plan further down to incorporate Janif and the other areas all the way to Northampton Boulevard. And again, we talked about pedestrian crossings of Military Highway. We realize that's going to take some time. We know it can't be done within 5 years, but hopefully in the long term, we'll see some pedestrian improvements. And right now, I'm going to ask Bob Mills, who's our architect, to come up and talk about some of the ideas we came up with. And again, don't shoot the messenger with Bob, but we thought these were viable ideas, and again, some of you may not like them, and there's always room for discussion, but you could just throw out a few of the things we came up with today.
Just to summarize, this is actually just one idea, one afternoon to throw something on paper just so that we could summarize some of our bigger ideas. And I'm going to start with the mall. We're talking about the demalling, taking it apart, still maintaining the Macy's building, the Penney's, the Sears box, and the theater. Taking out all of the mall area in between, creating some smaller junior tenants within. This becomes an outdoor mall. It could be a green, a lawn area with a fountain. Lots of trees, lots of pavers. This is really just the representation of demalling the existing mall and changing its character. Also suggesting the possibility of creating a number of other out parcels around the edge getting rid of the ring road and simplifying, reducing the amount of asphalt that has been there accommodating the former mall. Everything kind of revolved around the idea of getting multifamily, getting residential closer to the train station, putting some apartments near this neighborhood. And also other ideas, we were hoping that perhaps we could green up the street, whether it's more street trees to the side where we're going to remove, where we're suggesting removing of the feeder roads, but also maybe more street trees down the middle, down the median strip. We were also actually considering the idea of if we could get the city to consider the idea of reducing maybe by one lane the possibility of dropping medians all the way down this area as potential platform for an expansion of a transit down that road. Just thinking ahead, trying to find a place to land in regards to a platform for the spur. Let's see, other things. Oh, gateway. We are suggesting the idea of having some kind of visual gateway as soon as you come off of the interstate so that you know where you are, you recognize that you're entering the military circle area or its new name. And we're also suggesting the same thing on Virginia Beach Boulevard at this end and one at this end. Maybe they're just pylons on each side of the road that just let you, it's a visual cue to let you know that you're entering this district. Another thing that we've suggested in this particular plan is an expansion of the office area, medical office buildings of various sizes, keeping some of the buildings in place, reusing buildings, and letting this be more of a business office mode. This being retail and this being multifamily. I think that pretty much covers it.